Back in 1959, American writer Pat Frank published a novel entitled Alas, Babylon. In it, the residents of a Florida town of Fort Repose dealt with the fallout from a nuclear war. And although Fort Repose was fictional, it was based on the real-life city of Mount Dora, Florida. As Frank's book became a resounding success, life in Mount Dora began to mimic art. In fact, by 1961, the Cold War was in full swing. As the United States squared up against the Soviet Union, the threat of nuclear war seemed all too real. And in Florida, just 110 miles from the Soviet missiles in Cuba, the fear was intense. Although people went about their everyday lives as normal, they began to take measures to prepare for a nuclear attack. In schools, children were taught to take shelter beneath their desks. Similarly, sirens were set up to alert citizens of an impending strike. What's more, in many backyards across the country, homeowners began building shelters to protect their family from the devastating fallout of a nuclear bomb. And in Mount Dora, a group of prominent citizens were busy putting their own survival plans in place. Several belonged to the Mount Dora Yacht Club, including Lake County Health Director Dr. James Hall, and tycoons Theodore Mittendorf and William Baker. Together, they came up with the idea of pooling their resources to build a giant, shared survival center. In time, the complex would become known as the Mount Dora Catacombs. The group, which also included the mayor of Mount Dora, a bank president, a school superintendent, retired teachers, and a minister, approached J.G. Ray, a local builder. Apparently, they believed that a group shelter would offer many economic and social advantages. Psychologically, we're social animals, Hall wrote in his 1962 book, Medical Economics, and there's safety in numbers. I believe that group will survive with fewer problems than will the single family attempting to go it alone. If the father was separated from his family, his wife and children wouldn't have to fend for themselves unaided. They'd be with other families. In fact, Hall believed that between 5 and 15 families were optimum for a survival shelter. In the event, the idea was so popular in Mount Dora that 25 families committed to the cause. Each of them invested around $2,000, which is about $15,000 in today's money. Although he was offered a place in the shelter as part of his fee, Ray declined and instead accepted $60,000 to complete the job. Over the course of the next 6 months, a crew of 15 people worked secretly to construct the 5,000 square foot shelter. One of the group's fears was that others in the community would find out about the shelter. So, because they did not have room for everyone, Hall told curious visitors that he was building a croquet court. Impressively, the group even went so far as to construct a real grass court to complete the illusion. When it was finally completed, the shelter lay hidden 6 feet underneath an orange grove on the outskirts of the city. The entrance was marked by a 2,000-pound steel door, designed to swing shut and seal off the occupants in the event of a nuclear attack. If anyone was unlucky enough not to make it in time, they would be abandoned to their fate. Inside, the shelter boasted more than 30 rooms, including 25 private quarters, one for each family. There was also a recreation area, 2 bathrooms, and a decontamination room. In fact, most reports consider it the largest bomb shelter ever built on private land. The shelter was designed to accommodate 100 people for as long as 6 months, if necessary. Apparently, the group believed that this would be long enough for radiation levels on the surface to fall. After that, they would re-emerge, equipped with uncontaminated seeds, and begin to rebuild society. In order for the inhabitants to survive so long underground, the shelter had plenty of mod cons. For instance, a diesel engine installed in a soundproof room would provide power. Meanwhile, an air conditioning system and dehumidifiers would help to maintain a comfortable environment. In the lobby, a kitchen supplied with an electric burner would allow the inhabitants to cook meals. With no access to the outside world, they would need to survive on canned fruits and vegetables and potted meats. And to make sure that nobody tried to take more than their fair share, an armed security committee was established to maintain order. Additionally, a medical committee was set up to care for the health of the inhabitants. In fact, the group boasted 2 doctors, 2 nurses, and a pharmacist. The shelter was also equipped with plenty of medicine and a clinic where major operations could be performed. If anyone died, they were to be buried in crypts in the walls so that no one needed to risk going above ground. However, it wouldn't all be doom and gloom inside the shelter. Into each individual unit, the 25 families also packed the essentials that they thought they would need during an extended stay underground. Among them were chocolate bars, children's toys, and even party gowns, suggesting that at least one family plan to keep their spirits high. As the powers that be failed to annihilate themselves over the years, each family continued to pay $200 a year in upkeep costs. The money covered the expenses associated with keeping the shelter stocked and ready should the nuclear apocalypse arrive. However, in the end, the family spent just one night underground during a drill. By the time the 1970s rolled around, the threat of nuclear war had faded. Indeed, many of the people who had initially set up the shelter had died or left town. Eventually, the electricity and dehumidifiers were turned off, and mildew began to grow on the walls. Today, the Mount Dora catacombs belong to a private owner who acquired them after purchasing a property nearby. He hosted a few parties there, but then closed up the shelter, unable to think of a use for the vast underground space. Now, aside from the odd, curious visitor admitted on a guided tour, the rooms are left to the cockroaches. But with nuclear war in the world's headlines once more, will they soon find themselves evicted in favor of human occupants?